skeletal and
skeletal.
What is slow expansion? What is rapid expansion? What is dental expansion? What is skeletal expansion? So what is skeletal expansion? Skeletal expansion involves expansion of either maxilla or mandible. The basal bone will be expanded. So can we expand mandible? Technically, we cannot expand mandible. We can expand maxilla because of the sutures which it has been attached to the skull. So there are sutures within the bone and also surrounding the bone, right? So what are the sutures that attaches maxilla to the skull? What is the first suture that involves expansion? Mid-palatine suture or intermaxillary suture. The other sutures are? Zygote. All the maxillary sutures along with the adjacent sutures. What are they? Zygomaxillary, frontomaxillary, nasomaxillary, lacrimomaxillary, pericomaxillary. There are many other sutures with which maxilla is attached to the frame. So growth is first in the transverse dimension. So TSP, if you remember, in this in the third year. So transverse dimension growth is first, followed by sagittal growth, followed by vertical. So the vertical growth is the last year complete, which means we have less time to treat a patient transverse deficiency when compared to the patient with vertical deficiency. So if there are any crosswise, you have to treat them first rather than the open one. So transverse dimension works in the skills. Followed by sagittal. Sagittal means stand for posterior dimension and plastic, and for posterior dimension. Transverse means scissors by crosswise. What are scissors by crosswise? Scissors by is also basal bone acts expansion, there will be no splitting of the maxillary suture layer. So slow expansion is dental expansion. Here rapid expansion is maxillary or skeletal expansion. Okay, what is rapid maxillary expansion? It is also called as rapid palatal expansion or split palate, because you are literally splitting the intermaxillary suture. It is a skeletal type of expansion that involves separation of mid palatal suture and movement of maxillary shells away from each other. So this is the appearance. It is only in the premolar region, right? That's what we said in the previous. Initially, your face has been accommodated with certain kind of the particularly in the dentures and mixed dentures. In slow expansion also, separation of maxilla and maxilla is happening in deciduous and mixed dentures. So why is it? So far we have learned that in slow expansion and orthodontic expansion only teeth will be moved. But here they can separate maxilla in deciduous and mixed dentures. So what is the age for mixed dentition? The age of 12 to 30. So when will the interpalatal suture or mid-palatal suture get ossified? 40 years, around 40 years is the age where the mid-palatal suture gets ossified. Till that time, even with orthodontic courses also, many orthodontic courses also, you can expand maxilla to certain extent. Not like rapid palatal expansion, but to certain extent you can expand maxilla via slow expansion also. So, but how much is the percentage there? Skeletal changes will be around 16 to 30%. But what about skeletal changes here? 50 to 60% of skeletal changes that you see in rapid palatal expansion. Are we clear enough? Then, what is the amount of force there? Several ounces to 2 pounds. What is the amount of force there? More than 5 ounces. Okay. And what is the intermolar width there? 8 mm. So dental expansion can bring only 8 mm difference to 8 mm. Here, can think about 10 mm. So, what is the amount of time required in slow expansion? 2 to 6 months, sometimes beyond that also. Sometimes it may be 1 year. But here, it requires hardly 4 weeks. In the first week itself, you will see changes. I talked about these changes also in the previous class. What is the first change that you will see? Can be one change that you can see. We discussed this in methods of gaining space, right? What is the one change that we can see within the first 2 weeks? What's happening if the maxilla is moving, if the palatine cells are moving away from each other, what will you observe? Space in between the human anatomy, histology. Any concept is similar, right? Yes or no? Fine. So the morphology of metal sutures has been studied by Nelson. So how many stages of development of the sutures are there? So there are three stages. What is the first stage? This covers the infantile gill. So the suture is in which shape? Y shape, and it is broad. Okay. So this Y shape with the mountain bone placing it. V shaped groove between the two halves of maxilla. So in the first stage of impalpating suture, what is the shape of it? Y shape. In the second stage, it is first stage is infantile suture. So in which age infantile suture? Infantile stage. First one year is called infantile stage. So the later stages are called juvenile stage. Of course, the other names for pediatrics is like toddler, all those names will be there. But for infantile suture, the next stage is juvenile pediatrics, where the suture is found to be more wavy. Wavy or close to the serpentine fashion. So in the first stage, it is Y shaped stage in the shape. In the second stage, it is more. Pattern is there, but it is expanding a bit. In the third stage, on the adolescent period, adolescence is till the age of 14 to 16 years away from developing adult stage. So, in the adolescent stage, the suture is characterized by more cautious force increasing interdigitations. Right? So, this is the third stage. These are the developmental stages of implants, patterns. So, I should be more about this. We have to do the orthodontic treatment before the end of this stage. Maybe orthopedic treatment or expansion of maxilla. If you do this after this stage, what will happen? It is already getting ossified. So you see, expanding an already ossified tooth is what you can break in. Ossification means already the hard calcium. Now that is formed, right? The bone is already formed between the two bones, right? This ossification is formation of new bone, right? So already bone is formed and you are trying to expand into it. Either break the bone or you have to attempt for slow expansion. So you cannot do rapid expansion. Buccolingual discrepancies could be either genetic or environmental. Buccolingual discrepancies means the transverse discrepancy. Buccolingual means this direction, right? So the transverse discrepancies could be either because of the genetic means by inheritance itself or by environmental. So what could be possible environmental factors? Buccinator mechanism, right? If the tongue is so small, right? So the extra oral forces will be more and they will push the both maxilla and mandible in the oral cavity. So there will be constricted arches. Constricted arches are buccolingual discrepancies, right? So any of these reasons could be possible. So according to Weber and Power, so many constricted maxillary dental arches are result of abnormal function. So if the functioning of your stomatomatic system is not proper. So in my knowledge in previous classes, I have told you about long face syndrome. Do you remember that? Long face syndrome? What is long face syndrome? functioning of the stomatognathic system. Understood? Howard in his experimental work created narrow maxillary lateralis in which to identify conversion from nasal to obligatory oral response. If you get this point, so far we have talked about complex syndrome, that is because of mouth breathing problem. Right? So he, Howard, conducted his experiment in monkeys where the breathing has been changed from nasal to obligatory oral respiration. It is mouth. So he came to a conclusion that because of mouth breathing, there should be restricted maxillary dental arches. Keeping that aside, all patients considered for RMD should be examined for nasal obstruction. If obstruction is found, they have to respond to a otolaryngologist or an orthodontist. Why? See, even if we expand the arches or even if we expand the maxilla, the root cause, if the nasal obstruction is not removed, there is no point. Again, the patient will open the mouth and breathe. So, no matter how much you expand the maxilla, the patient will again fall back into the same old respiratory habit. So, first you have to check for any nasal obstructions. If there are any nasal obstructions, you have to ask them to consult a otolaryngologist or an ENT specialist. Clear the pathway and then attempt for orthodontic treatment. So, you have to remove the root cause first. If the patient doesn't have any nasal blockages, you can directly start with the orthopedic expansion. RMD excellences are the best examples of true orthopedic expansion, as the changes are primarily produced in the skeletal structures rather than the dental structures. So, what are the indications here? When will you indicate the rapid palatal expansion of the patient? First one is posterior crossbite associated with real or relative maxillary dentition. Anterior crossbite can be related. Sometimes you may or you may not attempt for RMD. Most of the times, posterior crossbites are a very much definitive indication for rapid palatal expansion. In class, we malocclusion of dental or skeletal origin. That's what we have said. In class, we malocclusion, what is the typical feature?
Reverse
overjet, which is nothing but crossbite. Which means in posterior crossbite, most of the times, 90% of the times, you have to attempt for RMD. In anterior crossbite, you have to check the possibilities, the reasons. If the reason is just because of any occlusal discrepancies, or if it is because of the positioning of the tongue, or if the teeth are just retroclined. Posterior crossbite, most of the times, will be skeletal discrepancies. The anterior crossbite should be because of any of the reasons. It could be because of occlusal discrepancy or tongue position or just normal retrocline teeth also. Okay? So you have to check between those two. Then cleft palate patients. Cleft palate patients obviously have restricted narrow maxillary arches. So in those patients also you have to go for RMD. What is PSF? 4-0 anterior septum.